Well, good morning, church, and welcome back to our midweek devotion. This is something that I love doing, and it's great to come to you midweek and be able to share some scripture with you, spend some time together in prayer, and hopefully you feel fed through this. That's, of course, our goal, is to make sure that spiritually we continue to be fed, that we don't just wait for our Sunday worship to pour into the scriptures, but that it's something we do on a more regular basis as well. I thought about recording outside today, but it's a little chilly, so I'm here in the comfort and warmth of the office. And I want to start with prayer. We're going to pray together the collect for the first Sunday of Advent. This is the prayer that we would have said, or that we did say this past week. If you were with us and if you were watching online, it was a prayer that we said, you know, at the beginning of our service. But I think it has some great words in it, so I want to pray it again now and listen to what it has to say. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now, in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns, to you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Well, as I was kind of praying through what to go over with y'all today, what to share with you today, I've been pouring into the scripture lessons for this coming week, the second Sunday of Advent. And, you know, we typically have an Old Testament, an Epistle, New Testament reading, and then, of course, the Gospel, and then a Psalm in there as well. And I was looking at that, and of course, you never can bring all those passages into the sermon. So oftentimes, something gets overlooked. And I thought, you know, I wasn't planning on including this passage from 2 Peter this week in the sermon. Let's look at that this morning, because I think it's an important passage. I think there's some good things in it. So we're going to look at 2 Peter. This is from the third chapter of 2 Peter. And again, we're going to read this Sunday in church, but I wanted to go ahead and spend a few minutes today talking about it. And it says, of course, this is Peter begins this chapter by saying, "This is the second time that I'm writing you, and I'm stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles, knowing that this, first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own deceitful and sinful desires. They will say, 'Where is this promise of coming? We haven't seen Jesus return.'" And Peter goes on to say, you know, basically people are going to come and tempt you. They're going to come and say, "Oh, this is a bunch of baloney." And what Peter is telling the believers is, stay true to the faith. Jesus told you he's going to return. The prophets have said that he will return. He fulfilled so many prophecies when he was born in the first place. So let's believe those same prophets and prophecies when he says that he will return. He goes on to say, "But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance." Again, Peter's pointing out something that we know, that the Lord wants everyone to be reached. And he says that he won't return until the gospel has reached every end of the earth. And so we have a mission to share that good news as well as to believe that good news. Jesus isn't going to return until those things happen. And it's not that, oh, it's been a few thousand years and he should be coming back. The disciples thought he would be coming back in their lifetime, and it still hasn't happened. But we have to understand that time to God in heaven is not like time to us here on this earth. Peter continues, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought to be in the life? Excuse me, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God? Again, we are called to live holy and godly lives. We're called to have Christ at the center of our lives. And if we do that, then it doesn't matter how many days on this earth we may live or when Jesus returns, because we're living with him already in our hearts and in our souls. And of course, when he does come, it's just an even more glorious day for us. So we need to remember that. Let's live right now as if Jesus is returning, as if he's returning any moment. And let's live with him at the center of our lives. Again, he continues, "Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace, and count the patience of our Lord as salvation." So again, we need to remember that he is coming, and he will come, but it will be in his time, which we can't fully understand and grasp. You know, this is a time of year, there's a lot of movies on TV, a lot of Christmas movies, and I feel like there's kind of a general theme in a lot of those movies of this anticipation of Christmas coming. And there oftentimes seems to be some kind of plot where, is it going to happen? Will Santa arrive? Will the elves get the work done? Is this Christmas going to go off without a hitch? We put so much anticipation into this, but every year, December 25th rolls around, and every year there end up being gifts to some extent under the tree and in stockings. I can't think of a year in my life, and I think most of us can say that we have never gone without Christmas happening. Now, Christmases have looked different from time to time. We've had Christmases with family. We've had Christmases where maybe we were apart from family. But every year it still happens. And I think that if we believe that that will be the case, and as we watch, you know, in these Christmas movies, these Christmas-themed movies, Christmas always ends up happening in those films too. You know, not necessarily without a hitch, but Christmas always happens. And so if we believe that that will be the case, if we believe that the world around us will go on and that December 25th will arrive as it always does, then shouldn't we believe in God, our Creator, who has fulfilled hundreds of prophecies and who has divinely inspired the scriptures to be written and who created us and the world around us? If he says he's going to come back, we should believe he will. We should know and trust that he will. Just like every year we celebrate his birth at Christmas, we should also be preparing for his return in this season of Advent. And again, you've heard me preach that before, but we really do need to take that seriously and prepare for his return. Prepare our lives and live in such a way that he is evident in our lives. I want to close this morning with another prayer. And this is a prayer, again, I pull a lot of the prayers from the back of the prayer book that are just kind of those for whatever situation you may find yourself in type prayers. And this is a prayer specifically about Christ being formed in us. And in the season of preparation, the season of Advent, hopefully a season where we are not just living in the feast, but also understanding a season of fasting and growing spiritually, I felt like this was a great prayer to pray. And so, again, listen to these words. I think it addresses Jesus and his humanness in a way that we can understand and relate to. So pray with me. Lord Jesus, Master Carpenter of Nazareth, on the cross, through wood and nails, you wrought our full salvation. Wield well your tools in this your workshop, that we who come to you, rough-hewn, may be fashioned into truer beauty by your hand, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit live and reign, one God, world without end. Amen.